Sri Hari, who came as promised to Prahlada. The Vamana Avatara was the fifth incarnation of Sriman Narayana in the Krita Yuga. Tradition has it that the performance of Ashwamedha Yaga, horse sacrifice, 100 times will entitle one to the status of Indra. Mahabali was performing it for the last time to achieve that honor. Sri Hari at that time takes the Vamana Avatara. Vamana signifies a short-statured one, and in the guise of a celibate Brahmin asks Mahabali to gift him with 3 paces of land to be covered by his foot. When Mahabali asks whether he could give it after the Yaga, the Lord, as Vamana, demanded its being proffered immediately, and assuming his gigantic form, measured the world with 1 foot of his, the heavens with the other, placing the 3rd one on the head of Mahabali. Shukracharya, as also Mahabali's grandsire, Prahlada, were present there at that time. Mahabali, by the force of the Lord's foot placed on him in the gigantic Trivikrama form that the Almighty had assumed then, was slowly sinking into the earth. Prahlada, at that juncture, asked the Lord, "Swami, is this to be the fate of my grandson?" "No. Amongst the 4 lokas, Atala, Vitala, Sutala and Patala, he is going to the Sutala Loka that has everything. I shall also be present there. In the Savarni Manvantara, Mahabali can become Indra. My Lord, if you should also be going away to Sutala Loka, when can I have your darshan? When will you make your appearance again, please?" "There is time for that." "Swami, will you be making your appearance here itself?" "No, not here, but elsewhere. Where Sri Vikrama comes out and how it was can be seen later. But what the attendant circumstances were and why the Lord appeared again will be relevant here. Kushasthali is a sacred place, carrying a reason for it being called so. Kusha is a sacred grass, the Darbha grass. King Revata Raja of the Krita Yuga was using Kusha grass for performing yagas with the intent that his kingdom should become prosperous. The place of the yagas came to be called as Kushasthali for that significance. It was not Kushasthali alone, but his entire kingdom that became prosperous then. Besides, under the influence of his punya or merit, Kushasthali and the surrounding areas remained affluent even after his time. However, at one time, a demon by name Kushasura started creating trouble for all, the rishis not excluded. It was the abundance of the sacred Darbha grass that had attracted sannyasis and yogis to Kushasthali, but they were helpless against the violence and brutality of Kushasura. The celestials and sages counseled Kushasura about the impropriety of his actions, but could only confront his loud laughter in jeer. In utter disgust, they cursed him. "The Lord will not spare you." "Oh, Lord, is it? Where is he? How can he come here?" "He is the omnipresent one. He will be in you as also in us. He will come by land or through the sky." "Let him come. If he travels on land, his legs will not be spared. If he should come flying, he will be reduced to non-entity even before landing. This Kushasura can do anything that he wills. All of you, get away from here, else you will not be alive," said Kushasura, driving them all away in great ire. The celestials and the seers indulged in prayer to the Almighty, left with no other alternative to quell the atrocities of the demon. The Kushasura thundered, "They say Sri Hari will come, who can break my vigil and get into my domain. Can it ever happen, either by land or from the sky?" Reveling in seeing the ascetics and the devout ones suffering his cruel acts, "Prabhu, we can no longer bear these evil doings. You had, for the sake of Prahlada, emerged from the pillar as Sri Narasimha to annihilate Hiranyakashipu. Swami, we are unable to tolerate any longer the tyranny of Kusasura. He has no knowledge of your power. He boasts that he is keeping a watch over your movement on the land, as also in the sky. Prabhu, please come to our help in the manner you deem fit and destroy him, prayed the victims with immense grief at heart. One day, when Kusasura's atrocity had touched its zenith, his palace shook a bit. The demon king and the inmates came out startled when it trembled more violently. A little later, a pestle emerged out of the earth, and before it could be known what that phenomenon was, it came out fully, splitting the earth. When Kusasura went near the fissure to see the strange object, Lord Trivikrama split the earth wider and came out with Gada in the upper hand, Chakra in the left hand, Padma in the lower right hand, and Shankha in the lower left hand. Presenting himself as Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma, Trivikrama. On coming out, he got the better of Kusasura and slew him in no time. The one who was boastful that none could come by land or through the sky to destroy him was thus killed by Sri Hari, who appeared in the form of Trivikrama to execute the extermination emerging out of the Sutala Loga. It may be recalled that when Trivikrama had placed his foot on Mahabali and pressed him down the earth, Prahlada, seeing his grandson sinking slowly, became perturbed and had asked the Lord about it. Srihari had indicated then the time when Mahabali would be blessed the status of Indra, enlightening also that he would be emerging out of Sutala Loka at some point of time. Accordingly, it was to kill Kusasura that he made his appearance out of the Sutala Loga. The sacred Kushasthali is the place where the Lord made his advent, now called as Dwaraka. The spot at which Mahabali went down to the Sutala Loga, the Lord too exiting from there to that Loka, is not Kushasthali. That was a different place, and the Lord's emergence to kill Kusasura was another locale. Sri Hari is present everywhere, yet these are some leelas orchestrated by him for certain reasons. He comes from below the earth once and in a manner altogether different, causes his divine presence in the same mother earth on another occasion, thus bestowing sanctity to Gopi Chandana, as seen earlier. The Deeparadhana to Sri Krishna with the cry Jai Dwarkadish raised by the devotees in chorus is the kind of routine worship there every day. The sight of the devout clapping their hands and raising them up in worship will instill bhakti in everyone having darshan there. Since Sri Krishna had ruled over Dwarka, the decorations and adornments for him conform to the customary royal grandeur. The Abhisheka for him cannot, however, be seen by devotees. The decorations vary from hour to hour, and their splendor will always be effulgent. For uninterrupted worship of this Dwarka ruler, 36 families are doing seva to him in turns. The Panda doing the puja changing every fortnight. The next turn for a Panda will come only after 70 weeks. In Dwaraka, the fluttering of flag in different colors can be seen throughout the day from anywhere in that vicinity. The 157-foot temple tower there has access to its top from inside. There are contractors employed for changing the flags 5 times a day. I felt the craving to get one of those flags to tie it atop our proposed Granthalaya, but consoled myself that the time for it was yet to come. My heart pined that the Hanuman flag that was flying atop Sri Krishna's chariot when he was proffering the Gitobadesha should be replicated in the Granthalaya setup. Of course, if the boundless grace of Sri Hari Vayu Guru be radiant on us, nothing is impossible, was the solace that I felt. About Kushasthali, now called as Dwaraka, its origin and the one who was responsible for its coming into being cannot be covered in a short description. A brochure available there gives information in the following manner. The Dwaraka existing now and the Moola Dwaraka are identified as one and the same by some researchers, while others vehemently contradict it. It is opined by one set of researchers that Dwaraka city springing up in the midst of the sea and later getting submerged in the waters is not supported by any evidence, while yet others contend that many have undertaken research and reliable evidences in support of it are being gathered as a continuous process. The leaflet further provides an insight into certain mythological information, like the Moola Dwaraka having been created in the midst of the sea, only to prevent the entry of enemies, and yet those like Shishupala had, during the absence of Sri Krishna, caused havoc there in their attempt to plunder the riches it boasted, as also about Gandhari's curse that in 36 long years the Yadavas should become extinct, and as a result of it, Dwaraka city getting submerged in the sea, devouring the entire clan of Yadavas. It has also been mentioned therein that the temple on the bank of the Gomati River had been built by Sri Krishna's grandson, but had later been destroyed by the Mohammedans. It was rebuilt in the 10th century, according to that source. Further, researchers say that the present Dwaraka is of the 5th or 6th century AD. In 1473 AD, Sultan Mohammed Begda, besides founding Okha, raised to ground the Dwaraka temple, and it was rebuilt later as per the history of the place. Like this, many stories are told, and if seen in depth, more information may come to light about the Dwaraka drowned in the sea. Let us now get immersed in the most important part of Dwaraka, where we can find a rare object that cannot be acquired from anywhere else in the world.